Because one says that
early in the morning, after 3,
okay, that's not important. The most important to understand that on the first day of the week, that is, you know, what we have in the gospel, and they agreed among themselves that, you know, on the first day of the week. And the second point is, why did they go there? Why did they go there? So they didn't go there, you know, Mary Magdalene, and, you know, her friends. So they went there, not with the certainty that now we are going to see, you know, the risen Christ. They, you know, they didn't go there. Biblical scholar, dear brother, help us to understand the reason why Mary Magdalene and other Mary went to see the tomb. Why? Because of the two purposes. The first one is to anoint. No. Is to anoint the body of Christ. But in the Palestine, by that time, to anoint someone who died after 3 days, it could be, you know, like madness. You know, you are going in there to anoint someone who is already decomposed. You know, that could be, you know, a madness. That's why other biblical scholars say, let us only base on the mourn, not the mourning, but the mourning for Jesus. They went there to mourn. You know, that's what the biblical scholars say, to mourn. Okay, that is what we have, you know, with regard to the intention. The reason why they went to see the tomb. And now, we have the angels. You know. So, in one of the Gospels, said that the angel became the one who came and, you know, first, before I speak about the angel, let me speak about the stone. You know, the stone. Dear brothers, seriously speaking, the stone in the four gospel is very, very important. It's crucial. Why? You know, because the four of them, they emphasize on the removal of the stone. But now this stone has got a theological interpretation. The interpretation is, first of all, the stone, you know, stop anyone from entering in the tomb. You know. And another meaning is that the stone, you know, prevents, you know, the dead person to come out. So the reason why the four of them emphasized on the removal of the stone is to tell us that, you know, they were preaching something that they verified. They saw it, that, you know, it was empty. That's the reason why they emphasized on the removal of the stone. And now let us go to the angels. Okay, how many? There were only 3. Actually, from a metaphysical point of view, angels, you know, are beings made of form, and we human beings are made of, you know, matter and form. You know, we are capable to see it because we are made of, you know, matter. But now, when we say that the angel, you know, is made of, you know, form only, can see. For me, that is, you know, very difficult to understand, but let us apply, you know, use it, you know, our theology. The reason why the angel came is to help us to understand that, you know, the one who was there is no longer there. Now he's, you know, risen, you know, from the dead. You know, from the dead. Now, dear brother, let me speak about, you know, the appearances, you know. Here, please, dear brothers. You know, let us pay, you know, attention. For me, that's the most important part of my presentation, the appearances. Why? Because in the four gospels, we have the appearance of Christ 2:11. 2:11. And we have the appearance of Jesus, you know, 2, you know, women. So 2:11 and 2 women. Like this. And then, dear brothers, in order to understand the appearance of Christ, biblical scholars, they use different words like, you know, komaiomai. That is a Greek verb to tell us that Jesus was someone who was sleeping, and then he stands, you know, he stands and peripateo, you know, he walks. Those Greek verbs help us to understand that the appearance of Jesus was very much important. And dear brother, please just bear in mind,
the 11, you know, that Jesus himself appeared to. And that 11 is very important. You will see very soon. And now, the other thing that I would like to say, dear brothers, is with regard to Anastas Necron and Anastas Ecnecron, which means the resurrection from the dead and of the dead. So what's the difference between to be, you know, raised or raised from the dead and from of, I mean, of dead, of the dead? Mm. So biblical scholars say that no, that is just a, you know, a kind of theophany of the resurrection, meaning that something that they used, you know, in order to help us to understand the agent of the resurrection. Was Jesus himself or God? Because we have that Jesus is God, then if Jesus is God, you know, from the dead, it is, you know, very difficult to understand that Jesus was, you know, risen from the dead, you know, by, you know, someone else, you know, by God, but of, meaning that Jesus himself, you know, through his own power, you know, he, you know, is dead, you know, stand in the very patel. Book. So it's just they just tell us that the from and of is just a matter of a tradition, but we believe that Christ, you know, is God. So whether you grasp it as a, you know, ek necron from or necron of, you know, there is no any problem as long as you are able to understand that the Christ, you know, is God. And now to conclude, you know, the second part. Dear brothers, when I say sepulchrum vacuum and how Jesus tooth finally appearing is an empty tomb, they are historical. They are historical, as Wesley tells us. To say that all these two events are historical does not mean that I have scientific explanation for it, but they are historical. Meaning that when you are within the church, dear brothers, the church founded by Jesus Christ, you cannot say that empty tomb, it's nothing. Empty tomb within the church is one of the proof to understand the resurrection of Christ. The appearance are very important to understand the anastasis of Christ. Now, if you say no, you know, they are nothing, then guys, you are trying to excommunicate yourself from the unity of the church. You have to say that that is a historical fact, and we have to believe. But now, the problem, dear brothers, the problem comes in when I will start speaking about, you know, Uta Hankeman, you know, Transcung, and Father Cornelius Alphonsus Kielenbeck. That's now the problem will come, dear brothers. That's the big problem, that's the challenge. Why? Because we have the cut of St. Paul to Corinth. That's the problem. By the way, this card, I mean this letter of St. Paul, it appears first done, you know, the Gospels. This was written in 57. I mean 56 to 57. Corinthians. And the first Gospel, as we have seen, the Gospel of Mark appear in the 60, you know, 7. So we see. So then the problem comes in, dear brother. First of all, St. Paul says, you know, he died and he buried, you know. Buried, you know. To be buried is very important within Jewish tradition, because the worst thing that can happen to you, dear brother, within Jewish tradition is when you are not buried. You know, to be buried is like, you know, something very, very good in the respect toward your body. And now, raised on the third day. Here I'm speaking, you know, based on the, you know, my theological father, you know, Schillerberg. On the third day, dear brothers, it does not mean, it has nothing to do with the, you know, a focal, you know, point of time. It has nothing to do with the chronological date. It has nothing to do with the, you know, date counting. It has nothing to do that God was waiting for third day in order to to rise, you know, Jesus. It has nothing to do with that. So, the third day means that. And in order to understand, we have to go back to Jewish notion, which is, you know, that in order for someone to be considered as dead, he has to be, you know, day after 3 days. So, you are dead, dear brother, when you are, you know, you are dead for 3 days. Then we can understand the reason why St. Paul says on the third day to help us to understand that the death of Christ was not something, you know, it was not seeming death, you know, something that, you know, appeared to be, you know, that, no, for Paul says, I mean, the interpretation of Scalabe, third day, meaning that Jesus, you know, rose from the dead, you know, anesthet, you know, on the third day, meaning that, you know, the third day, you know, is a theological interpretation. That is an important event within the life of Jesus Christ. You know, that's what we have about the third day, not, you know, a chronological day. That now, I said the problem, why? Because in the gospel, in the four gospel, there is nothing about the appearance of Jesus to Cephas, to Peter. That's a problem. That's a problem. See, it's a serious problem. Because we have in the gospel, you know, the appearance of Jesus to 11, Mary Magdalene, and nothing about, you know, the appearance of Jesus to Cephas. And what about the appearance of Jesus to James? And the 500 people, brothers and sisters, that the gospel, you know, did not mention. That is a big problem here, brother.
And now, as I said, now I will base on those, you know, theologians that, you know, they gave headache to the church. Hans Kung, Skrabeck, and Walter Heinrich. So, dear brother, Kung says, these things of it's a popum vacuum, that is a legend.
There's a legend.
And Skilabek also following the Skilabek says, hey, not the Skilabek, sorry. You know, what a handy man, following the argument of Skilabek, I mean, Transcom says, hey, dear brother. You know, the empty tomb is legend. Why? Because St. Paul did not mention. If it could be very, very important, then St. Paul could mention. But he didn't. Why? Because it's not important. I agree with Hans Jung. That's legend. And now they are like, you know, Benedict of 16, father of the church. He said, okay, good hunger man. And the way classmates, you are saying that it was legend. Following the argument of Hans Jung, tell me something. There are many things in the gospel, you know, about Jesus that we never find in the letters of St. Paul. Does it mean that they are legend? So Walter Hackman was quiet. He didn't say anything. But now, let me go to, you know, Father Skilabek. Here is the end of my presentation. I couldn't finish without, you know, bringing my author, Skilabek. You know, dear brothers, Jesus Christ was someone, you know, who used to unite the disciples. You know, the reason why the disciples were united is because of Christ. That is the reason why the disciples were united. But now, when Jesus was put to death, you know, those disciples who were united, thinking about the love, when they realized that their master, the one who used to unite them, was killed, the disciples were scattered. But now we have empty tomb, Edward Skilabek, and appearances. Okay, we do have it. But first of all, dear brother, empty tomb, says Edward Skilabek, it tells us only that the body is missing. Yeah, to say that the body is missing, meaning the resurrection, that is for me nonsense. But now, for Edward Skilabek, the focus is
The disciples were scattered. What did happen to the, to, you know, those disciples who were scattered to come together and to preach, you know, the anastasis of Christ? What happened? Oh, it was going to make sense. It can't be empty tomb, because empty tomb just tells us that the body is missing, and it can't be the, you know, how Jesus, you know, that's funny again. The appearance of Jesus, you know, because the appearance of Jesus, according to the tradition, it poses already a belief, you know, in the resurrection. So, what happened then? Edward Skillerbeck, they were scattered and then they came together, locked, they started speaking. What happened? So, Edward Skillerbeck was thinking of the issue. It can't be this true that the church believed that, no, there's. So, he was thinking, Eric, I know what happened. It was conversion of the disciple. Oh, they were converted and then they decided to speak about, you know, the analysis of Christ. Meaning that the disciples who were scattered, you know, they got converted. They start speaking about the love. They start thinking about the life of Jesus.